too cold or too hot?
Too hot. Excuse me, we have to have the chairman of deacons to come and change the temperature.
Is that too hot according to who?
Y'all just bear with us. We had trouble with this morning, same way, so it's a coming.
What makes your mom happy?
Me. When we help her clean the house.
When she sees me win something.
When I be nice to my brothers and sisters.
Whenever I hug her.
What makes your mom mad?
I don't go to bed. Not cleaning my room and not doing stuff that she's told me to do.
My dad says he's gonna do something, but he never does it.
What is something your mom does every day?
Read her Bible.
Watch TV.
Cleans.
Clean the house.
My mom always cleans the house.
questions.
What is something your mom always says to you?
Be good to your friends.
She needs to be fed, clean up my room.
How are your neighbor and aunt with you school?
She says to me, Beth.
She loves me.
I love you.
How old is your mom?
61.
She's 30.
21. I think she's 60.
Like this much, but now she turned like this much, so she's 0.
What is your mom's favorite thing to do?
Read.
Play with me.
Spend time with us.
Color. Shop with me.
Hang out with me.
Go to church.
What is your mom's favorite place to go?
To my tanka.
The spa.
To my cousin's house.
The book.
The church.
How are you and your mom the same?
We both have tan skin.
Both of our favorite colors are red.
Well, we both like green.
We both have freckles.
Mommy has two eyes that matches one eye of me, because I have two colored eyes as my daddy.
How are you and your mom different?
She has blonde hair, I don't.
She works most of the time and I play most of the time.
That way you know I'm the same eye color.
She cooks very well and I can't.
He has big hair and I don't.
I wake up really long, wakes up late.
What is your favorite thing about mom?
She's pretty.
She always hugs me.
That she takes me fun places.
That she loves me.
She says I love you.
That she loves me and she takes care of me.
How do you know your mom loves you?
Because she tells us that every day.
Because she gives me a hug and kiss every night before bed.
Because she smiled at me
by giving me a hug and kiss.
I don't know why, because she gives us kisses.
Because she always makes macaroni, because I love that.
I love you, Mom. Happy Mother's Day.
Love you, Mom. Happy Mother's Day.
Love you, Mommy, big.
Happy Mother's Day. I love you.
I love you, Mommy.
In spite of the liquid sunshine we had today, but you braved the elements and came on, and I'm so glad. And you ladies, this is your special day, and we honor you and we are grateful for you. Let me make a couple of announcements. One is very major. Nobody told me. You know, I can plead ignorant for the first year. After that, I've got to know things. Nobody told me we don't traditionally have evening services on Mother's Day. So no services tonight. You go home, take an extra long nap, just enjoy your afternoon. No services tonight. What I have prepared for tonight, I'll work on and rework it this week, and we'll have it next Sunday night, okay? Remember our church-wide trip to the barbecue place on Tuesday? You see what time we're leaving and getting back. We've got a good number of people who are going, but we still have some room. So you sign up and meet us at 10:22. Also, you see about a church-wide meal 2 weeks from today. Appreciate so much the ladies who put this together. Thank you for those who've already given to our Mother's Day offering. We're well on our way. But hopefully after today, we will exceed our goal of $750. Baby shower for Bennett Sterling Goforth. Going to be on Sunday the 23rd. We thought his name was Benjamin, but his name is Bennett. So I appreciate Jane going through and hand correcting every one of these. That is over and above the call of duty. Also, this is the last call for our senior adult trip to Pennsylvania, specifically Amish country. We really need 30 to make the trip, but we don't have that number yet. So if you would like to go, please sign up ASAP. We have a gift for all of our ladies today, whether you're a mother or not. We have a gift. I was going to get our children to help pass these out, but most of them are gone. Bill and Susan Graham's third daughter, they're dedicating a baby this morning in Covington, and all of the families are over there. So ladies, what we're going to do, I'm going to remind you, you come up after the service and get you a water bottle. Hopefully these will be something that you'll use and find useful. But we want to say we love you and we appreciate you. There's something we're not going to do this morning. We're not going to recognize the oldest and youngest mother. I was advised this week that a lot of women don't like to tell their age. You know, now, I feel like once you hit 80, it ought to be no secret. But we're not going to do that. We just want to recognize all of our mothers and let you know how much we love you and how grateful we are for you. I want to pray for us and just dedicate this service to the Lord Jesus Christ. Heavenly Father, we thank you for those who gathered for worship. We know that the weather has kept some folks at home, and we certainly understand that. I do pray for those who are in harm's way right now. We know there are some serious storms passing through, and we trust your protection. And Lord, we place ourselves completely in your hands, and we're going to allow you to build a hedge of protection around us. We thank you so much for our precious mothers. All of us, Heavenly Father, are who we are and where we are because of the love and patience and faithfulness of our mothers. And Father, I am keenly aware that today is not an easy day for some people. Some people have lost their mothers in the past year. For some, maybe their mothers have been deceased for 4 or 5 or maybe 10 or 50 years. And a day like today brings back sad memories for them. But I pray, Heavenly Father, that your presence would turn that sadness into joy and gratitude. And we're reminded of that quote from Tennyson, "'Tis better to have loved and lost than never to have loved at all." Father, we also pray for women throughout the world who are struggling to have children. They've had problems with infertility. And Father, as one who has tried to minister to couples who've experienced that heartache, I especially pray for them that you would work your will and your way in those lives. Father, we thank you in advance for how you're going to move and work in our midst today. It is exciting to be here. We recognize that we are on holy ground. I almost feel like slipping my shoes off because I sense your presence, and I believe that you're going to move in a mighty way. And I pray that we would stand aside, that every human element would be removed, and that your spirit would have the total freedom to move and do what he desperately wants to do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Jesus is mine, no one for me.
She's like the merchant ships She bringeth her food from afar. She riseth also while it is yet night, and giveth meat to her household, and a portion to her maidens. She considereth the field and buyeth it. With the fruit of her hands she planteth a vineyard. She girdeth her loins with strength and strengtheneth her arms. She perceiveth that, that her merchandise is good. Her candle goeth not out by night. She giveth her hands to the spindle, and her hands hold the distaff. She stretcheth out her hand to the poor. Yea, she reacheth forth her hands to the needy. She's not afraid of the snow for her household, for all of her household is clothed with scarlet. She maketh herself coverings of tapestry. Her clothing is silk and purple. Her husband is known in the gates when he sitteth among the elders of the land. She maketh fine linen and selleth it, and delivereth girdles from the merchant. Strength and honor are her clothing, and she shall rejoice in the time to come. She openeth her mouth with wisdom, and in her tongue is the law of kindness. She looketh well to the ways of her household, and eateth not the bread of idleness. Her children rise up and call her blessed, her husband also, and he praiseth her. Many daughters have done virtuously, but thou excellest them all. Favor is deceitful and beauty is vain, but a woman that feareth the Lord, she shall be praised. Give her of the fruit of her hands, and let her own works praise her in the gates. Let's pray together. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this passage of Scripture. I pray that you would use it and apply it to our hearts. There may be people here who say, well, I'm not a mother, I'm not a woman. This doesn't apply to me. But Father, this applies to every one of us. These are principles that are not just restricted to one role or one gender. These are principles that are relevant and applicable to every one of us. And I pray that we would see clearly what it is you have us to understand. In Jesus' name, amen. There was a woman named Ann Jarvis who grew up in a minister's home in Philadelphia. Now, like so many ministers, her father really neglected his family. He spent all of his time at church. He was always out ministering to people and neglecting his family. So Ann Jarvis' mother, who was also named Ann, became the primary caregiver in the family. Ann was one of 11 children, 7 of whom died in infancy. Of the 4 who survived to adulthood, 1 of them was mentally challenged and lived with her mother the rest of her life. Her mother did 100% of the work. She bought the food, she cooked the food, she cleaned the house, she took care of the children. Ann Jarvis' mother, Mrs. Jarvis, was very, very godly. Every night she prayed with her children, they read the Bible together, and all of them grew up to be radiant followers of Jesus Christ. One day, Ann decided that she would donate an entire day to honoring her mother. She said, now, Mama, I want you to stay in bed all day. I'm going to bring you breakfast in bed. I'm going to just shower you with flowers and gifts. This is your day. We are celebrating you. Well, that went on for a couple of years, and Ann's friends started to notice. The neighbors in the community thought, now, that's a good idea. Why don't we take one day to honor our mother? By 1910, every church in Philadelphia was taking one day a year and honoring and celebrating all of the mothers in their midst. Well, the idea finally reached Washington, D.C. And in 1914, President Woodrow Wilson signed a bill that enacted and instituted the second Sunday in May as Mother's Day. That is one of the few laws that has ever passed unanimously. Nobody would dare vote against a mother. So now Mother's Day has become one of the biggest holidays of the year. It is the biggest day of the year for long distance phone calls. It's the biggest day of the year for cards, even more than Valentine's Day. That sort of surprised me. It is the biggest day of the year for flowers. Maybe you went to Walmart to get something out of the cooler and weren't able to find anything because there's a real shortage because of COVID. All of these things, candy, flowers, hats, all of those are wonderful gifts that we give to our mother just to acknowledge how much we love them. Let me tell you how we celebrated Mother's Day when I was a kid. Early that morning, my brother and I would go to the fridge and we would pull out a little plastic box, and in that box was a gigantic corsage, an orchid. I mean, it was as big as the flowers here on the table. And we would attempt to pin it on my mother. We always drew blood because we kept missing. But my mother would wear that orchid. We would get to church, and all of the men would be wearing boutonnieres. Y'all remember this? Those whose mother was still living would wear a red boutonniere. Those whose mothers were deceased would wear a white boutonniere. Then we would sing songs like, "Mama's Teaching the Angels How to Sing." Y'all remember that? Another song, "If I Could Hear My Mother Pray Again." And then we would have the recognition of the oldest and the youngest mothers. It's a large church, and we always ended up with a tie. And we would have to get down to months and weeks and days, and that took forever to winnow out those two special women. Then we got home. My dad and brother and I would go to the den, and we would read the newspaper, and we would watch the television, and we would listen to the radio while my mother prepared a huge meal. She would cook the food, she would clean up afterward, all the while we were sitting there reading the newspaper. Later on, we would go and visit my two grandmothers, but that is how we celebrated Mother's Day. Now, I hope you will do more than that. Guys, you need to take your wives out to eat. Children, take your mothers out to eat. And I'm not talking Dairy Queen. You take them to someplace nice, someplace that's going to cause you to have to sacrifice. Or you go home and prepare her a feast. You tell her to sit in her favorite recliner and read a book all afternoon. You let her take a nap. Sometimes I'm kind of intrigued by what they do in the African country of Togo. They have an interesting way of observing Mother's Day there. In Togo, anyone who's in prison for crimes against his mother is rounded up and publicly executed. Every year, you've got hundreds of men executed for crimes against their mothers. And you may choose a more traditional approach to Mother's Day, but perhaps that might be an idea for the federal government. Now, 100 years ago, Ann Jarvis was convinced she had the greatest mother on the face of the earth. I want you to know right here, right now, she's dead wrong. I have the best mother on the face of the earth. I have never a single time heard my mother say anything negative about anybody. In fact, she defends people. I might go home and kind of poor mouth somebody, but she always defended people and spoke up for them. She's a great prayer warrior. Anything good in my life is the result of the fact that my mother has been on her knees interceding for her. I had the greatest mother-in-law in the world. I can't tell any mother-in-law jokes because I absolutely loved her. And I tell you why I liked her. She thought I was the funniest guy on the face of the earth. You know, a lot of the family just rolls their eyes. But her mother just thought I was so funny and just laughed and laughed and laughed. And I had an audience anytime I was around Dorothy Felty. My wife is an incredible mother. Both of our children have strong character. They have a strong work ethic. They have college degrees. They are gainfully employed. You know, Jordan, as you well know, is here every time the doors are open. And all of that can be attributed to their mother. They have grown to be kids of great character in spite of their father, not because of their fathers. So it is entirely appropriate that we honor you ladies and your mothers today. The Bible is unique in that it spotlights great women of faith. I don't understand why every woman in the world is not a believer. The Bible elevates women, it liberates women. Every other holy book, I'm talking Koran, Bhagavad Gita, you name it, they denigrate women. You know, they allow men to beat their women. Koran says you can beat your wife, just make sure the stick is no more diameter than that. Koran says, you know, a man can take up to 3 wives. Why would anybody live that way? Why doesn't every woman in the world want to be a believer? Because the Bible elevates and spotlights women of faith. For example, Moses' mother, remember her name? Her name was Jochebed. You know, we don't remember her name, but we remember the fact that she had such a passion for that baby that she was not going to allow him to be sacrificed by the hand of a bloodthirsty Pharaoh. She put him in a basket, set him afloat, and that started a great adventure that led to him being God's liberator. What about a woman named Hannah? In 1 Samuel, you've got a woman who struggled with infertility. Her husband's other wife had all sorts of children, and she belittled Hannah. In those days, not being able to have children was considered a curse from God. She prayed for a child. The child finally came. His name was Samuel. And she took him and dedicated him and literally handed him over to Eli, the high priest. And Samuel himself became a great leader of the people. What about young Timothy? He was a traveling partner and a protege of Paul's. He became a pastor. Just about any time Timothy is listed, his mother and grandmother are also listed. You've got Timothy, Eunice, and Lois. In a lot of the churches I've served, they have a T-E-L class. Yeah, I was at church in Arkansas for 7 years before I finally figured out what T-E-L stood for. Timothy, Eunice, and Lois. No mention of a father, but his mother and grandmother are spotlighted. What about Mary, the mother of Jesus? She's not one to be worshipped, but certainly she is one to be admired. She's an example of faithfulness and obedience, and she was there at every point in Jesus' life. It is interesting that the greatest mother in the entire Bible is anonymous. You've got a woman described here whose name is totally lost from humanity. We know that Solomon wrote the first 29 chapters of Proverbs, and he covers dozens of subjects. It's hard to preach through Proverbs because he jumps from subject to subject, talks about working, hard working, talks about family relationships, talks about alcohol, talks about money, talks about sleeping late or the lack thereof. In chapter 30, on a chapter written by Agur. We have no idea who he was. Then in chapter 31, you have a chapter contributed by King Lemuel. Lemuel is a word that means totally devoted to God. So we know he was a godly man, but we have no idea who he was. You know, people have speculated, but bottom line is nobody really knows who King Lemuel was. He's describing his own wife and his own mother in these verses. 22 verses of praise. Actually, these 22 verses correspond with the letters of the Hebrew alphabet. You know, English has 26 letters. The Hebrew language has 22. So verse 10 corresponds with Aleph, the first letter of the Hebrew Bible. Verse 11 corresponds with Beit and so forth. Gimel, Dalet, Hey, Yovah. All of these letters of the Hebrew Bible. So really, this is a poem. You could have gone to the local Walmart in Jerusalem 2,500 years ago and bought a Hallmark card that had this very same poem. A poem of praise to his wife and his mother. So what does he say about his wife? But furthermore, and more important, what does he say to us today? First of all, he says, model mothers live virtuously. Virtuously. Look at verse 10. Who can find a virtuous woman? For her price is far above rubies. Virtuously there is a military term. It is a military term that literally means warrior. I am looking for a warrior. My wife, my mother is a warrior. And I'm grateful for that. This word is only used one other time in the Old Testament. It is used of Ruth. You know, Ruth and her sister Orpah, that's where they get the name, they were married to these foreigners, these pagans. Both of the husbands died, and Ruth had a mother-in-law named Naomi. Naomi said, you know, I'm an old woman. My son is dead. Go back to your own people. And, you know, Ruth said, entreat me not to leave thee or forsake thee. Wherever thou go, I will go. Your people shall be my people. Your God shall be my God. Where you die, I will die also. Where you're buried, I want to be buried there. So she pledged herself to her mother-in-law and her mother-in-law's God. Well, they got back to Naomi's home region, and Ruth began to work in the fields of a man named Boaz. And Boaz noticed her character and her integrity and her inner and outer beauty. And in Ruth 3 and verse 11, he says, I see you are a woman of noble character. You could translate that. I see you're a warrior. You are a warrior. Women, you are warriors. You know, there's a place for soft-spoken, demure women who are sort of shrinking violets and wallflowers, and there's a place for that. But I tell you, it is God's intent that you be warriors, strong and assertive and making your voice known in your family and your society. After the Civil War, there was a French sculptor by the name of Frederick Bartholdi. He wanted to give a gift to the United States of America to celebrate the end of the Civil War. He went around and collected donations, got about $4 million raised. He kickstarted it by giving his entire life savings for this project. He finally gave our country a gift entitled Liberty Enlightening the World. Now, you know it as the Statue of Liberty. There's a picture. Now, later on, when he was interviewed, someone asked him, who is the model for that statue there? He said, you know, I searched the entire country looking for a woman of strength and nobility and honor and character, a woman with warlike qualities. And he said, you know, I finally went back to my own mother. She personifies those characteristics better than anyone I know. So actually, the Statue of Liberty is a statue of Frederick Bartholdi's mother, a warrior for the glory of God. So model mothers, these women that Lemuel are talking about, they live virtuously. And ladies and gentlemen, you ought to do the very same thing. Be a warrior for the glory of God. Number two, model mothers work diligently. Let me just summarize. Verse 13. She goes out and finds wool and sews it by hand. You know how she found it? Wasn't just, you know, in the notions department at Goldsmith's. She had to go out and shear the sheep. She had to go out and obtain it by hand and work with it and make something out of it. Verse 14, she goes a long way to find food. In those days, literally, you had to go out every day and find food. And basically, it was, you know, I'll kill it and I'll cook it and you'll eat it. So every day she went out and rounded up food for her family. Verse 15, she's up before dawn, making sure her family's needs are met. You remember your mother? You remember getting up and she's there in the kitchen making biscuits and red-eyed gravy and fried up country ham, and she's, you know, sitting there drinking her coffee. Many of you can remember that. Up before the chickens, making sure that the family was provided for. Verse 16, she goes out and buys a field. That really wasn't even legal in Hebrew society. Women were not allowed to own property. But this woman excelled to such an extent that nobody had a problem selling to her because they knew that she would back it up. Verse 18, seemed like she never sleeps. She's just always up working. Verse 19, she's always working a spinning wheel. Verse 27, she's never idle. In other words, she's the true manager of the household. I am amazed and mystified at the work that many of you women do. You're the chauffeur for the family. You're the baseball coach and the football coach for the family. I remember my grandmother, who was 85 at the time, out pitching the baseball to us, helping us to know what it was to play baseball. You know, you women are the psychiatrist and the psychologist and the trained counselor for your family. Your children are coming to you with problems and you're expected to give an answer. You're the business manager. You write the checks and make sure the checkbook is reconciled and pay the bills, etc. You're the medical professional. Anytime your child has a sickness or an injury, the child comes to you. And you've got to diagnose it and you've got to treat it. You're the resident expert on everything. You know, your child comes to you and asks you, why did the chicken cross the road? What came first, the chicken or the egg, etc.? And you've got to have a ready-made answer. You're the PTA president. You're the room mother. You're the school teacher. So many women homeschool now, including some women in our church. You're the school teacher. You're the principal. You're the guidance counselor. You're the school resource officer. You're the policeman. Did you know if we paid women according to union scale, if we paid you according to what you do on a daily basis, we would be paying you $220,000 a year. Fellas, go home. Reach in your wallets. Pay her. Acknowledge what she does for your family. There's a question that I stopped using a long time ago. When I meet a woman, I do not ask, do you work? They work harder than I do. I'll ask, do you work outside the home? But I'm not going to ask, do you work? Because that's a rhetorical question. I know they work. There are some of you, you've not had a salary job where you clock in, clock out. You've not had a salary job in 50 years. But you can work circles around just about every man in our presence. We appreciate it. So these model mothers, that they live nobly, they work diligently. Number three, they care devotedly. They care devotedly. Verse 20, they are compassionate to the poor. My mother's mother, Dorothy Tyre was her name, told me that when she was growing up, any time a tramp would come through, they would give him a meal. They would try to help him any way he could. And tramps would take pieces of chalk. And they would put X's on the sidewalk in front of homes where they would find help and compassion. Knowing my grandmother, I know their home always had an X. Does your house have an X on the sidewalk that people know that they can come to you and find help? Verse 21, they're ready for anything. They don't have to worry about the future. I've been in some of your homes. You've got enough canned goods. You could survive a seven-year famine. You could survive a nuclear winter that went on 10 years. You're prepared, and I'm going to come to your house if we ever have a famine, because you could feed an army. Verse 27, she watches over her household. I guess one way to describe her is she's sacrificial. She sacrifices her sleep. She sacrifices her leisure time. She sacrifices her personal comforts. You know, something I noticed as a teenager, my mother is a delicious dessert cooker, and she'd make a pie or she'd make a cake, and there'd be three slices left. And I can remember my mother to this day saying, you know, I'm not hungry. I don't think I want a second piece. What she was saying was, you know, you and your brother and your dad can have those three pieces that are left over. I may want a piece, but I'm not going to take a piece. Number four, these model mothers speak wisely. Notice what it says in verse 6. She opens her, 26. She opens her mouth with wisdom, and in her tongue is the law of kindness. The Hebrew there literally means she speaks God. Anytime she opens her mouth, she is conveying pearls of wisdom, and you ought to listen to them. Your mothers instruct us in so many different ways that they teach us about all sorts of subjects. Let's see if you recognize any of these statements. My mother taught me to appreciate a job well done. If you're going to kill each other, do it outside. I just finished cleaning. Mothers teach us religion. You better pray that comes out of the carpet. Mothers teach us time travel. If you don't straighten up, I'm going to knock you into the middle of next week. You heard that. Mothers teach us about osmosis. You shut your mouth and eat your supper. Mothers teach us about contortionism. When you look at that dirt on the back of your neck, mothers teach us about stamina. You're going to sit there until all of those lima beans are gone. Mothers teach us about weather. Your room looks like a tornado hit it. Ever heard that? You know, women teach us, or mothers teach us about the circle of life. I brought you into this world and I can take you out. Mothers teach us about behavior modification. Stop acting like your father. Mothers teach us about geography. There are millions of less fortunate children in China who don't have wonderful parents like you do. Mothers teach us about anticipation. You just wait till we get home and I tell your father what you've done. Mothers teach us about medical science. Don't cross your eyes. They're going to get stuck that way. Boy, I heard that all the time. You know, mothers teach us how to read minds. Put your sweater on. Don't you think I know when you're cold? Mothers teach us about medical miracles. When that lawnmower cuts off your foot, don't come running to me. Mothers teach us about genetics. You're just like your father. Mothers teach us about roots. Shut that door behind you. Do you think you were born in a barn? Mothers teach us about justice. One day you're going to have kids, and I hope they turn out just like you. Not going to point any fingers, but I notice you giving some evil looks to the woman sitting next to you. This woman we're talking about speaks the very language of God. She's not coarse. She's not crude. She's not crass. I hate, hate, hate profanity. Profanity is the sign of ignorance. If you don't have sense enough to come up with a good word like gobbledygook or nincompoop or something like that, don't even say it. I just hate profanity, but I really hate it from women. When I was worked at the hospital, I got cussed out on a regular basis. You know, I was the representative of God. And people got mad at God, and I mean, there wasn't a day that passed I didn't get cussed out. One day a woman really unleashed on me, and she kept saying, "Jesus this, Jesus that, Jesus this." Finally, after about 5 minutes of that, you know what I said? I said, "He sure is. He sure is. He sure does." She said, "What are you talking about?" I said, "What you keep saying is, God saves. God is our Savior. Every time you say the word Jesus, you're testifying to the fact that God saves us." You know, when I pointed that out, she got even more hostile. That didn't help at all. But that's the exact opposite of the model mother we're talking about here. Words are so incredibly powerful. You know, you can ruin in 30 seconds what took you 50 years to create. One little outburst and you can ruin your reputation for the rest of your life. That's why James talks about it. You can use words to build up or to tear down. These model mothers use their words to build up. They lived nobly and they care. They work diligently. They care devotedly. And they speak wisely. Fifthly and finally, model mothers believe profoundly. He says in verse 30, you know, favor is deceitful, beauty is vain. That doesn't last. What we spend so much money on, that's going to go away sometime. You're not always going to look like you presently do. That's just not important. He says what really matters is to fear God. You know, that's not living in terror. That's just a reflection and an understanding of who God is and what He can do. You know, she enhances her husband's reputation and her family responds to that faith. And then finally he wraps it up in verse 31. Give her of the fruit of her hands, let her own works praise her in the gate. The word works there, the Hebrew word that's used there, that really is singular, really says let her work praise her. Not a multitude, a plethora of activities. There's only one work that earned her the gratitude of her family. It wasn't her cooking. It wasn't her cleaning or her sewing or her management. My mother is an incredible cook, but you know, if you ask me what we had for supper on March 18th, 1971, I don't remember. Frankly, you know, I remember foods that she cooked, but I really can't think of a single meal that she prepared and set on the table. You know, what I do remember, what I'll always treasure is she loves us unconditionally. She praises us. She prays for us. She encourages us. I think she is more beautiful now than she ever was, but we recognize that beauty is something that fades away, but working for God, fearing Him, understanding His presence and His importance, that is what really matters. You know, I preached a few months ago about Mary and Martha, Jesus' best friends, and Martha ran around making sure everything was right, made sure the silver was polished and the crystal didn't have any water spots on it, made sure the food was elegant and beautiful and delicious. And you know what her sister Mary did? Mary just sat at the feet of Jesus and listened to Him. Martha came along and complained, "You know, my sister's a gold brick, lazy thing sitting there not doing anything." You know what Jesus said? He said what Mary's doing is a whole lot more important than what Martha's doing. You know, it's fine for you to go home and get your china and crystal out. But I tell you what's more important is you sitting at the feet of Jesus and listening to Him and just drinking in everything He has to say. Let me just say, friend, it really doesn't matter if your kids are a couple of minutes late to school. It doesn't matter one bit if your kids' clothes are wrinkled when they get out of the car. It doesn't matter one bit if your beds aren't made. It doesn't matter one bit if you get home today and what you put in the oven has become a burnt offering. That doesn't matter. It doesn't matter if you're a couple of days late on your Visa bill. It doesn't matter that the dog has made a mess in your living room. That doesn't matter at all. What matters is that you love Jesus and you point your family to them every day. You know, the human family is an illustration of the body of Jesus Christ. You know, Jesus Christ is the bridegroom walking down the aisle. We're the bride of Christ, and one day there's going to be this physical union, and we will be in the physical presence of Jesus every day. But you know, what we experience here sort of prepares us for that. Human families represent divine family. And maybe you this morning need to come and become a part of that divine family of Jesus. You need two families. Really, you need three families. You need an earthly family. You need a heavenly family. You need a church family. That's why we invite you to come and unite with Papa Corner this morning. You know, you pray about it. If God leads you our way, you come and be a part of what He's doing here. Listen, He's doing some great things. And we want you to come and invest your life here. And you need to come and just acknowledge here at the altar your need for God and your dependence and your desire to serve Him more faithfully. Maybe some of you ladies ought to just come and say, "Lord, help me to be the woman described in Proverbs 31. Give me the strength and the courage to go home and just embody those qualities." Steve's going to come and lead us in a hymn of commitment. The ladies are going to make their way to the instruments. And I'm going to stand out front and receive those who would come. Steve, what are we singing this morning?
Softly and tenderly.
Softly and tenderly.
Jesus is tenderly calling.
He's knocking at your heart's door. And I hope you'll say yes and open the door and allow Him to come in and do serious business, whatever He needs to do in your life. So let's stand together and sing.
Father and Father of glory.
afternoon, the liquid sunshine has stopped, so you can make a beeline for your car and beat it. Remember, no services tonight. We'll put a sign up in case somebody happens to show up. But you enjoy your afternoon. We're going to sing together and be dismissed. Don't forget our ushers are at the front and the rear. If you'd like to give something to support the Lord's work, let's sing together. God bless you.